reader at this time, we jump into the middle of a story that's been told for hundreds of years. It's a story of cities decorating their streets and their sidewalks. It's a story of trees and ornaments and fireplaces, of gifts and wrapping paper and ribbons. There's expectation and wonder and hope, a deep hope that drives us back to the beginning of the story. Because it all starts here. It starts in a manger with a baby and an angel and a scared teenage girl in love with a misunderstood young man who thinks she's worth it. It's about a child who will bring light into darkness, joy into despair, revealing a God who will redeem it all. A God who is leaving the glory of heaven to pursue the glory of the cross. A God who is becoming flesh and blood and skin. A God who is loving and offering all people a pathway back into the relationship for which they were created. It's too rich to comprehend and too beautiful to dismiss. This is Christmas. This is the story of stories. And it all starts here.
Right before they sing, where is David? David Bowen. Would you like to do your verse for us today?
Isaiah 9:6. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulders, and his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace.
Son, but also he is one of the students of our preschool, Little Friends Preschool. So that's a great advertiser. If you have a child in preschool, thank you, David Bowen.
Down there he lay, the
brightly shining. It is the night of our dear Savior's birth. Long lay the world its sin and error upon me, till He appeared and the soul felt its worth. A thrill of hope, the weary world rejoices, for yonder a new and glorious morn. Fall on your knees, oh, hear the angel voices. Oh, Christ was born. Oh, night divine. Oh, night. Oh, night divine. Truly He taught us to love one. For the slave is our brother, and in His name all oppression shall cease. Sweetness of joy in grateful chorus raise we. His holy name, Christ is the Lord. Ever, ever great to be. His power in
was born. Verse number 2.
Christ by highest heaven adored, Christ the everlasting Lord. Late in time, behold him come, offspring of a virgin's womb. Veiled in flesh, the Godhead seen. Hail the deity, pleases man with men to dwell. Jesus our Emmanuel. Hark, the herald angels sing. Glory to the newborn King.
Verse 1, one more time.
Hark, the herald angels sing. Glory to the newborn King. Peace on earth and mercy mild. God and sinners reconciled. Joy the triumph, rise. Joy the triumph of the sky. With angelic hosts proclaim, Christ is born in Bethlehem. Hark, the herald angels sing. Glory to the newborn King.
Now that same key, would you sing? Keep that key going. As worship now.
Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him. Christ adores.
One more time.
Oh, come, let us adore.
God is speaking.
You've heard it said, Christmas fills the air. Well, it also certainly fills the senses. We see lights of every color. We see friends and mistletoe. We smell all of our favorite homemade favorites like pine and wood-burning stove. We taste everything put in front of us. And maybe even a snowball or two. We touch our children's faces and our friends as we draw them close. But what do we hear at Christmas time? Do we really hear peace on earth? Are herald angels singing? Can we hear anything past the cash register ringing? Children laughing? Or that Christmas cookie that's calling your name? Do we hear too much? This Christmas, let us not forget that it all began when an angel of the Lord appeared with a startling surprise and a secret for a young girl to hold in her heart. And just like Mary, may we forsake everything else to simply stop and listen.
And heaven and nature sing. Even stoplights blink a bright red and green as the shoppers rush home with their treasures. Hear the snow crunch, see the kids bunch. This is Santa's big scene. And above all this bustle, you're here.
Of moving here and there, of buying this and returning that, of children screaming for Santa, some screaming at Santa. But not everyone we hear at Christmas is festive. Not everything is bright and cheery, because, let's be honest, just because it's Christmas doesn't mean our fears have gone away, that our anxieties have diminished, or that our loneliness has vanished. In fact, it may very well be the one time of year we need to hear from God the very most. The one time of year that we secretly wish everything else would get quiet and He would speak.
Looks to me like we got hired on for the same job.
You mean a bag holder here?
And purse carrier.
And I'm the personal assistant today from my wife.
Oh, and don't forget, taxi driver.
Yeah, and my all-time favorite, credit card hander outer.
Oh, that's a fun one.
There is a limit on this thing now.
Oh, that's a fun one. You here with your family?
Actually, I'm just here with my wife. She's out spending my money, of course.
Oh, okay.
Our money, she says.
Oh, okay.
What about you? Who are you here with?
Oh, I'm here with my two teenage daughters.
Oh, two teenage daughters. Yikes. Oh.
I know, right? Two teenagers, my credit cards, in a mall? Oh, man.
Oh, I do not envy you at all.
Hey, you guys from around here?
We're honestly about 2 hours south. My wife, she just likes for me to drive 2 hours to go shopping. She really loves to come up this way.
Oh, nice. Scoring some major points at Christmas time, huh?
Well, we'll see.
What do you mean, man? You're sitting here holding your shopping bags? You're the good husband if I've ever seen one.
Well, to be honest, I don't always feel like the good husband. Really, I feel like we're so far in debt anyways, what does it matter anymore kind of husband. You know that commercial? We're in debt up to our eyeballs. Yeah, every time I hear those cash registers ring, I just think, man, it's going to be such a terrible feeling when those bills finally come in January.
Mm. Well, see those two teenage girls over there?
Mm-hmm.
I get them for 2 days, the entire Christmas season. Mm-hmm. I mean, I'm their dad. But 2 days, that's it. Then they go to see their new dad. Oh, don't get me wrong. He's a great guy and all that. It's just that I'm their dad. I want to spend time with them. I remember when they were little, I used to come home, and instead of saying, I'm home, I'd yell out, who loves you, baby? And from wherever they're at, they come running up and just jump up into the sky and just jump in my arms and give me a great big hug. And they would yell out, Daddy do. Oh, I love that. I miss that so much. I want that back. Oh, I just want to spend more time with them at Christmas time. Before they get too old and think they're just too cool to hang out with their old man. Who am I kidding? They probably think that already.
Well, probably.
Sounds of generosity, the Salvation Army rings. And bells on TV telling me another angel got its wings. In every shop and every mall, on every side of town, they're ringing up the cells, and we all know that familiar sound. And I love all this season holds in store, but deep within there's something I want more. Speak to me, Lord, will you give me peace? Tell me truth, call my name through the Christmas noise. I long to hear your voice speak to me. I hear silver bells in silent night playing on the radio. In the churches and the restaurants, most everywhere I go. I love the sound of parents' laughter, watching children's plays, and all the crowds and marching bands at holiday parades. Oh, I love parties, family, and friends. But when quiet finally descends, speak to me, speak to me. Lord, will you give me peace? Tell me truth, call my name. Through the Christmas noise, I long to hear your voice speak to me. More than just the bells that ring, more than just the carols we sing, more than all these other Lord, will you give me peace? Tell me truth, call my name. Through the Christmas noise, speak to me, Lord, will you give me peace? Tell me truth, call my name. Through the Christmas noise, I long to hear your voice.
When, just like the gingerbread houses, we put so much care into decorating, things can so easily crumble. But oh, how our world has been changed forever with just a word spoken through a burning bush, a word spoken through a donkey, a word spoken through an angel. Our history is rich with ancient words that have changed things forever, but none are as powerful or as life-changing as the words that simply told, "For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and his name shall be called Wonderful."
Ancient words from long before, given to us by our Lord, and given time will prove. Ancient words are ever true. Behold, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and shall call his name Emmanuel. Given to us by our Lord, and given time will prove. Ancient words are ever true.
Would not trade places with you, man.
Well, me with you.
So we're quite the pair, huh?
Yeah. You know, one of my favorite parts about being at the mall is finding a bench like this, just so I could sit down, you know, pretend my feet are hurting. Tell my girls, my feet are killing me, you know? So I sit down so I can watch all the people as they walk around and stuff. Really cool.
That's so true. I do the same thing when my wife is out, spending that money. But you know what? I could watch people for days. I wonder where they're going. Where do they come from? What's in their bag? And how much did it cost?
Yeah, but it's kind of scary when you think about it, how much they're like us.
That's true. You mean broke?
Well, yeah, that too. But no, you know, what I mean is they're dreading the day of Christmas Day because they're going to be spending it alone.
Or during the most, what's supposed to be, the most wonderful time of the year, when people are supposed to be laughing and caring with their families, and they're not. They're scared. They feel alone. And they're terrified of what's going to happen in January when those bills start rolling in. Think how scared and how terrified people really are.
Yeah, I agree.
Hear not, for the Lord is with you. Hear not your enemies.
Fear not. Ironic, isn't it, that we are here today to celebrate a story that began with the words, fear not. Fear not, for I am with you. And suddenly, Mary was asked to lay aside her fear and uncertainty in exchange for a promise that would change her life, my life, your life, forever. For in that moment, heaven's loss became our gain. A prince would come to deliver us. A lowly child would become a risen Savior, and they would call his name Jesus.
King and friend, mighty and gentle on your throne, yet here with us, holiness, come to take on our sin, righteous judge, so merciful, humble one, the great I am,
Son of God and Son of Man, with all my heart, I worship all you are, perfect love revealed, one that we can understand.
Son of God and the Son of Man. How can this be? The Lion and the Lamb both refer to Jesus Christ. He is both the conquering Lion of the tribe of Judah and the Lamb who was slain. The Lion and the Lamb are descriptions of two aspects of the nature of Christ. As the Lion of Judah, he is the Messiah who would come from the tribe of Judah. As the Lamb of God, he is the perfect and ultimate sacrifice for sin. When John the Baptist sees Jesus approaching him, he declares, "Behold, the Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world. Jesus is the ultimate Passover lamb who saves all people from eternal death. When Jesus refers to himself as the Son of Man, what does that mean? Why does he say Son of Man and Son of God? Both of these expressions describe who Jesus was. Jesus was a man and he was God. He was God in human flesh. Son of Man. The term means Jesus was a human, a common term used 106 times in the Old Testament. It simply means a person was human. But when it comes to the New Testament, the term has an additional meaning. It still means a person who is human, but it is now used as a title for Jesus. Jesus was the ultimate human. He was God in human flesh. Son of God. Jesus has said that he was the Son of God. The Jews understood this term to be a claim of deity. They knew Jesus was claiming to be God. This is the meaning of the Son of God. The term Son of Man and the Son of God were both used by Jesus because Jesus was man and he was God. Together, they mean that Jesus was completely man and he is completely God. He was the Son, he was God-man. He was the eternal, holy God who came in human flesh. Without being a man, he could not have died. If he was not God, he would have been a sinner. But as the God-man, he was a sinless man, the perfect sacrifice, the sinless sacrifice for our sins. He returned to life and ascended back to heaven. There he sits on the Father's right hand. He hears our cry, and he sees our needs, and he will answer.
How can someone up there truly feel and understand what I am feeling?
How can someone who's supposed to be all-powerful and all-knowing truly know how broken I am during this season?
How can someone who sees this big world spot someone like me when I'm hurting or crying?
Get a hold of us.
to tell us I love you. God is speaking, I love you.
I think of the scripture that says, God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever would believe in him would not perish, but have everlasting life. I think of the scripture that defines it after Jesus left, that summarizes and said, the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. It's the wages of man and the gift of God that brings us hope and salvation. Have you ever thought about the greatest Christmas gift you ever got that you still have in the annals of your memory? Still touches your heart to think about it? Or maybe you're still overwhelmed as you remember being 7 or 10 or 12, whatever it was when you got that, probably the largest, greatest gift you ever got. We have pictures in my family of a little kid standing by a box that's almost as big as he is. The box is about 6 or 7 feet long, about 4 feet tall, and about 2 feet thick. Can you imagine how it felt when I walked out and I looked that there was the Christmas tree and there was all these presents and there was this giant thing that was there and it was wrapped. And I found out it was mine. I could not understand what it was. For the life of me, I couldn't recognize what in the world this could be. And I anxiously looked and waited for the moment that I would finally discover, what is that gift? Finally, it was my turn. And I went over to the gift and I opened it. And that's where we have pictures of my dad and I trying to work on it. He's trying to help me open it and look down inside the box. And I finally discover what it is. And he brings it out, and guess what it is? It's about 6 feet of bicycle. It's the biggest bike I've ever seen. Thick, tall, big, 26-inch wheels. And it was chromed, and all the spokes had the little white handles, and I think little ribbons coming out of the handles. And it had white walls, big, fat tires, beautiful ebony black on the paint. And I remember the wheels were beautiful chrome, gorgeous chrome. It said something on the front. It said Schwinn. It was a giant Schwinn bike, the biggest, most precious gift I'd ever seen. I don't know how many can remember the gift that you got that really stood out to you in your life, that special thing. Maybe it was a diamond. Maybe it was a doll. Whatever it was, that Christmas, it was so special to your life. And the one thing that you recognize in the midst of that is that what it meant, along with all the other presents, was that you were cared about. That at Christmas time, somebody was thinking about you. Somebody had thought about you and your life. And more than that, you were loved. I mean, that's the blessing of Christmas to the rich, to the poor, in every culture, in every country where they can afford a rag doll or a beautiful Barbie doll. The children come out, parents come out understanding the gift and the blessings of giving and receiving love and being loved. I wonder why we celebrate Christmas, even now, for the last 2,000 years or so. Why do we still enjoy it, even though it's so marketed and so forth? What is it about Christmas that we recognize to this holiday, there's not just turkey or whatever the meat is, that there's not just a time of saying it's the new year, that's not just a giving of presents, but there's this spirit of Christmas, is what they call it, throughout the earth. And it was the spirit of Christmas. We celebrate, I believe, the greatest gift of God, the gift of eternal life, the gift of Jesus Christ. The greatest gift that we've ever got is Christ. And Christmas is the Christ Mass. That's what it originally would mean, the Mass for Christ. Celebrating the fact that God gave to us His Son for our sins, the gift of life. And Christmas is a time when we remember that by emulating it, by us remembering and loving somebody and giving to them and receiving love from other people, all taking us back to the fact that God so loved the world that He gave His only Son, that whoever would believe would not perish but have everlasting life. And the greatest gift we've ever received is Jesus Christ, and that's the gift of forgiveness and mercy and love. At our house, I don't suppose we're taking it with us on this trip, but usually our kids come from around the world. They've never missed a Christmas, and one's, I think, 35, one's going to be 39. And they come back, and we have all our Christmas gifts, and we used to not really buy much clothes for them in September. We'd save up money and make those Christmas gifts also, so we'd have a ton of gifts, some dollar store gifts, clothes, pair of socks, whatever it was, and our kids just love opening it, and we still do that. We just get whatever it is, 50 cents, a dollar, and wrap it, and we just take a day or two and just keep sitting around giving gifts and receiving gifts. And when it's all done, there was a little pyramid my wife builds, and it has a number of gifts, big box, little box, little box, little box, and it's about this tall. And it used to be just for the two girls. And then we took on a son, Joey, my son-in-law. And then we took on Cobb, my son-in-law. And now my wife and I don't participate or partake of that pyramid of gifts, but before you leave, before Christmas is done, they have to open all of those, and one gets the big box, the next one gets the middle box, in order, the box after the box. And every one of those boxes is full of one more thing that says something to us, and that is, you have been thought about. But more than that, it says what the gift of Christ says, and that is, you're loved. You are just simply loved through our Christmas season. And it is that love that sent this Christ to us. It is love that sent this great gift to our hearts and to our lives. The only question we have every Christmas is, have I ever, and am I continuing to open the real gift of Christmas? Am I really opening the gift of Christ and the gift of the love of God? Because really on the tree and under the tree is the message that you are loved by God extremely. How many knows that the Christmas tree has a long heritage? And there was a time when there was the first Christmas tree. You probably don't know about that tree, but there was a time when there was the first Christmas tree, and it's in the Bible. And we celebrate it today. It was a tree that had grown and finally become tall, and then it was cut down. Only on this tree, the branches were removed, and it was taken down to just bare wood, and it was cut and formed into a cross. And the decoration upon the tree was a bleeding Savior, a loving Savior, the Son of Man, the Son of God. And it was really the most beautiful tree in the history of the world, because it was the great expression that God was giving something special to the world. Not just that it was the gift of salvation and the gift that keeps on giving, like that wonderful pyramid of forgiveness and eternal life and blessings, but behind the gift, there was the God so loved, the God so loved. And there he was, not under the tree, but on the tree. And there was the first Christmas present on the first Christmas tree that started the whole thing off, that said, world, person, individual, wow, do I love you. I love you so much. The only question is that we have in our day and every Christmas is, do you care that you're loved? Does it mean anything to you that you have been loved so graciously? Somebody says, well, you're going to care if you miss heaven. And I say, no, you're not going to care about the love of God then. You're going to care that you missed all the blessings of the Lord. The time to know whether or not we care about the love of God is today, as we experience the love of God and see it given to us, and then we recognize if it's of value to us. And I'll tell you how we know. When real love is given and it is accepted, it is responded to. That's the way love works. It's this miraculous thing that blesses. We experience a little bit at Christmas, but we really experience it through the gospel of Jesus Christ. When finally, many years ago in 1970, I responded, I said, yes. I opened that big Schwinn bike, except it wasn't a Schwinn bike, it was the love of God. And I took out the gift of love and I received it, put my name on it, took it back to my room with me. And I've carried it ever since for 46 years. I received the love of Jesus Christ.
Let us take our bells and remember, here is what we can be assured of this holiday season. He came, he lived, he died, and rose again. He saves, he heals, he hears, he speaks. Still today to you and to me. Through a friend, through a stranger, through a song, through his word, Emmanuel has indeed come. So listen, and this holiday season, you may just find yourself hearing the sound of children caroling, and the bells ringing, or a heavenly host of angels singing. Glory to God in the highest, and on earth, goodwill to